can't tell you how excited I am to have this event and have it with Dale Russakoff. She's an old and dear friend of mine, a former Washington Post colleague. And hello to all of you Washington Post people. It's sort of like a mini reunion here tonight. I'm so honored that she's here at Politics and Prose. Brad and I always love to have authors present books, especially when those books are extraordinary. So that reason alone would be one of the reasons I'm so delighted to introduce Dale. As you know, she'll be discussing her new book. It's called The Prize, Who's in Charge of America's Schools? It's truly an exceptional piece of reporting and writing. And if you don't want to take it from me, you can take it from the New York Times review, which said it's one of the best books about education to come along in years. And I just found out that Dale will be number 12 on the New York Times bestseller list after 1 week. So, amazing. But there are a couple of other reasons, sort of personal reasons, that I'm really happy to be able to introduce Dale. One is that she and I go back a long way. We were undergraduates in college together. And the second is that I finally now have the chance publicly to thank her for something, and that is for making me fully appreciate the adage, good writers are made, great writers are born. And the reason that I am thinking about that and thought about that as she was coming tonight is that years ago, Dale and I both worked at the Washington Post, and we were both on the Metro staff, and we were assigned to cover the Maryland legislature as a small team, of reporters from the Post. And one night, we were laboring over a rather mundane, inconsequential story together. And I don't know, something had happened in the legislature, and we were sitting at the computer together, and I had several goals. Make it clear, make it accurate, and mostly get it done really fast. So I was sitting there, you know, trying to do those things. And I realized that Dale was laboring over this story in a good way. She was considering every word choice. She was thinking about the flow of the sentences. She was thinking about the narrative structure of the story. And it dawned on me. I was at very best a good writer made, but I was in the presence of a great writer born. It didn't matter to Dale whether the piece was big, small, important or not. The quality of the writing just mattered. And I think that the next three decades of her work have proven that she is indeed a great writer born. You know, she's been a journalist for most of those past three decades at the Post, New York Times, and as a contributor to The New Yorker, where parts of the prize first appeared. And I don't want to get too sappy and say how great this book is, but let me just read a little bit from that New York Times review, which called it a brilliantly reported behind-the-scenes account of one city's attempt to right its failing public schools. And then the review went on to say, a lesser reporter might have succumbed to the seduction of such intimate access to the rich and powerful, but Russakoff maintains a clear-eyed distance, her observations penetratingly honest and incisive to what she sees and what she hears. I suspect some may have regretted letting Russakoff in. I wonder who. We couldn't have asked for a better guide. And not only did she immerse herself with those famous and rich people, she also immersed herself with the real people in the schools. And I think that, to me, was one of the most riveting and incredible parts of this book, and really a reflection of the profound humanity that she brings to everything that she does. Can I just end with this? I was on a radio show a couple days ago trying to come up with books that every presidential candidate should read. And if I had to pick one, this would be it. Please join me in welcoming Dale Russakoff.
Well, I'm really honored to be at this bookstore and incredibly honored by the introduction and by all of the friends who came tonight and gave up watching the debate so that you could be here. I hope you won't regret it. I'd like to tell you why telling this story became so important to me as a journalist. It began literally the day that this gift was announced. I had seen an article in the Star Ledger, the Newark newspaper, saying that the gift was going to be announced on the Oprah Winfrey Show. I had never watched Oprah, but I made sure to watch it on September 24th, 2010. And I was absolutely electrified to see this very young billionaire pledge $100 million to the Newark schools, and also to hear Cory Booker and Chris Christie talk about using it to revolutionize education in Newark, to do what so many people agreed was the most important challenge in the country, to at last make public education work for the nation's poorest children. To me, $100 million sounded like all the money in the world. And Booker, Christie, and the reform leaders who praised them, including Secretary Arne Duncan on behalf of President Obama, sounded so sure of themselves. "We know what works," was their phrase. They would take the best ideas of the education reform movement and bring them all to Newark. And in Booker's words to Zuckerberg, they would flip a whole city. I didn't believe they'd achieve change on this almost miraculous scale, but I expected to see dramatic advances. And I wanted to get as close to this process as I possibly could, because this is exactly what has fascinated me throughout my almost 40 years as a reporter, tracing the process by which big public policy ideas do or don't translate into actual changes in people's lives, and understanding why or why not. I saw what was happening in Newark as an opportunity to explore how the democratic process worked or didn't for very disadvantaged children. I also thought it was an opportunity to look from the ground level at the education reform movement, this very potent combination of billionaire philanthropists, charter school leaders, social entrepreneurs, and politicians in both parties who are seeking to upend the status quo of traditional public schools governed by large, usually unionized bureaucracies. The movement has spawned a furious debate over the shape of education nationally. When I started my reporting, the movie Waiting for Superman just had come out, portraying urban public schools as failure factories, teachers' unions as villains, and non-union charter schools as the solution to all of it. Two dueling websites on education had just gone online. One was called waitingforsuperman.org. The other was called notwaitingforsuperman.org. I was struck by how many real issues both sides, the reformers and the opponents, were leaving out. This impassioned national debate had a huge hole in the middle of it, and a majority of the children in Newark and in cities across the country were stranded in that hole. I'll give you two illustrations of this from my reporting very early on. For most of the first year after the gift was announced, Newark did not yet have a superintendent. A group of consultants, most of them from New York City and beyond, was calling the shots within the district, which was being run by the state. These consultants did some very important work, in particular getting a handle on the tenure process, which was basically dysfunctional. But the most public thing they did was to identify which of the absolutely worst district schools to close to make room to expand charter schools. One school they identified was called 15th Avenue School, where for years, barely 20% of children had been reading at grade level. Very little was going right for kids at this school, so it was designated to close, and one of the highest performing charter schools in New Jersey was to move in. This charter, as was its model, was starting with kindergarten only, and it would grow one grade each year. So no one currently at 15th Avenue School, a kindergarten through eighth grade school, could go there. The consultants decided that the 330 children of 15th Avenue would be transferred to a school just across Westside Park. Now, if you were looking at a map, this made perfect sense because the second school was geographically close and it was underpopulated, so it had plenty of room for the children coming from 15th Avenue. But if you knew the neighborhood like someone who lived in it, which the consultants did not, you would know that Westside Park is a very dangerous hangout for drug dealers and gang members, and that children as young as 5 or 6, or even 12 or 13, should not be walking through it every day to get to and from school. I attended a PTA meeting at 15th Avenue School, and the parents were absolutely terrified. They wanted to know how people who profess such concern for their children would come up with such a plan. Moreover, the school where they were going was no better than 15th Avenue. One father said, "They're not solving the problem, they're just moving the problem across the park." So the reformers had a really powerful diagnosis for what was wrong with the existing system, but they didn't have a formula for fixing it without causing tremendous stress for Newark children in the district schools where the majority of kids are still being educated. One thing I learned about education in cities, it's an ecosystem. Changes in one area have consequences in another, many of them unintended. Okay, scene two. I attended a public forum one Saturday morning on a new alternative high school graduation test. Fascinating, right? For the past several years, students who failed the regular high school exit test had taken an alternative that was much shorter and easier and was graded by their own teachers, so everyone who took it passed. The state was, it was really successful, and so were the students. The state was proposing to use a new test that would raise the bar and would be graded by a disinterested party. A number of civil rights organizations participated, and they argued strenuously against the new test. They had calculated that some 3,000 students in New Jersey who would have passed the test under the old system would fail it under the new one. As they put it, one of the most consequential things you can do to students who have the credits required to graduate is to deny them a high school diploma. I found myself wondering, how about denying them a high school education? If students couldn't pass this very basic test, what did a high school diploma mean? Again, here was a forceful, impassioned, important voice in the education debate, talking past some of the biggest problems children were navigating every day in Newark and cities like it. So it seemed clear to me that this was an opportunity for journalism, to write a full story of how both the status quo and the reforms were affecting all Newark school children, in charter schools and in district schools. I wanted to see education from every perspective in the debate, but most importantly from the eye view of children and the teachers who worked every day to reach them against incredible odds. If I could write a story, a book, about education reform in Newark that was indisputably true and thorough, essentially filling in the hole that existed in both sides of the national conversation, I hope that it could spur a more honest exchange about what children in schools in cities like Newark truly need to succeed. What should this conversation look like? I actually have a suggestion. Newark and other urban districts desperately need to get more resources to classrooms to support children and their teachers. The reform movement has a mantra. It says, poverty is an excuse for failure in district schools in Newark and across the country. That is unquestionably true for some people and some schools. But poverty is also a root cause of failure for children who literally are traumatized from growing up amid violence, family strife, and constant instability. Here's another example from my reporting. Avon Avenue School is located in one of the poorest catchment areas in Newark. I attended a kindergarten class there of 26 children, of which 15 had child welfare cases, alleged neglect, exposure to violence, exposure to drugs. Some of the children in that class were already so angry at age 5 that they routinely would hit other children and throw chairs at them and the teacher. So not only were these children unable to learn, they frightened their classmates to the point that many of them couldn't learn either. That class had one of the best teachers in any Newark charter or district school, but on many days her extraordinary skills weren't enough to overcome these challenges. She did not need excuses, she needed help. I also spent time in Spark Academy, a KIPP elementary school. Spark had some students, although not as many, who were equally troubled. They also had way more resources to support them and their teachers. They had two teachers in classrooms from kindergarten through third grade. They had a tutor for every grade to support children who couldn't keep up with even two teachers. They had 3 social workers who did therapy with a total of 70 children a week who needed emotional support just to learn. While Avon Avenue had the equivalent of 1 social worker who didn't have time to do any therapy. And Spark had a dean of students and family engagement whose job it was to make sure that there was an adult in every child's life to support the child's learning, if not a parent, a family friend, a godparent, a neighbor. The principal of Spark said there was no way that charter school could have had the academic results it did without those extra resources. Spark had these resources because KIPP gets more money per pupil to its schools than the Newark School District does, even though it starts out with less. The Newark District schools, like those in many old industrial cities, have been used for generations to do much more than educate children. They have variously been a patronage pit for local political bosses and also an employment agency to counter poverty and instability in the city. The district has jobs and sweetheart deals with contractors that no longer serve the schools or the education of children, if they ever did. Every stakeholder in education, from state governments to unions to parents to politicians to local community organizations and to the education reformers, ought to figure out how to get as many of these resources to children and the teachers and principals who know their needs best. Secondly, as state governments actively support the expansion of charters in urban communities, they should share responsibility for the upheaval and stresses placed on district schools, which still educate the vast majority of children in America. I think the education reform movement is starting to see this point. One reformer at a university in Washington State, who's very prominent in the movement, actually said to me, there should be a sort of pottery barn rule for proponents of disruptive change in existing school districts. You broke it, you bought it. There are lots of other issues to discuss, but I want to leave time for questions. So I'll just touch on one of them, the role of private philanthropy in shaping public education. For generations, the foundations of deceased early 20th century industrialists dominated education philanthropy. But since around the year 2000, living billionaires have displaced them. Bill Gates of Microsoft, the Walton family of the Walmart fortune, Eli Broad, the California insurance and retail magnate. They are making targeted, very large donations in hopes of disrupting the existing education system, which they see as antiquated and unequal to the task of educating the next generation. That's the context in which Mark Zuckerberg came to pledge $100 million to Newark, a city he had never visited. He hoped to transform public education on the same scale that he had transformed global communications from his Harvard dorm room at age 19. Like many philanthropists, he came to the cause through personal experience. His girlfriend, now his wife, Priscilla Chan, had worked as a teacher for a year after college, and when they socialized with friends in Silicon Valley, he was struck that their contemporaries treated her as if she were doing charity work. Yet, in his view, teaching was one of the most important jobs in society. He said his hope was to use his philanthropy to create a path-breaking new teacher's contract in Newark that could be copied in cities across the country and would have the effect of raising the status of teachers in society. His idea was to pay very large bonuses to the very best teachers, up to 50% over and above their base salary. These were the kind of rewards paid at Facebook, and he said he never could succeed without the kinds of people who came to Facebook, so how could public education do any better? Booker and Christie added to this a plan to expand charter schools and institute what they called systems change in the district schools, a state-of-the-art student data system, a new system for evaluating teachers and principals, a new accountability system. With charter schools and a district that ran like a high-performing business, they thought they'd arrive within 5 years at a model, a proof point, they called it, that Zuckerberg, with his philanthropy, could then take to one city after the next, solving the education crisis in all of urban America. Well, it's 5 years later, and it hasn't happened. Zuckerberg did end up spending $100 million in Newark, and matching funders spent a second $100 million, but now there is no model of educational excellence in Newark. They spent $60 million expanding charter schools. They spent about $50 million on a new teacher's contract that holds teachers more accountable for effective instruction, but did not revolutionize the pay system as Zuckerberg had hoped because the district couldn't afford it. They spent $20 million on consultants, many of them paid $1,000 a day, to implement the system changes they wanted at the district level. And they set aside another $30 million to be spent on assorted other labor reforms, including a new principal's contract. They didn't flip a city, as Booker had promised. The doubling of students in charter schools will undoubtedly increase student achievement in Newark, because Newark charters, unlike many across the state, significantly outperform the district schools. But outcomes for the 60% of Newark children in the district schools have not improved, despite the $89 million committed or spent on labor contract reforms and the $20 million spent on consultants. In fact, district school performance on the state standardized test in grades 3 through 8 has gone down, not up, since this reform effort began. One reason seems clear. It was contained in an email that an aide to Booker wrote early in the negotiations over Zuckerberg's gift, saying this, MZ's money is not going to the classroom. As I said, the emphasis was on systems and management changes, running school districts like a business, expecting better management to travel through the system and translate into better student performance. The reformers weren't wrong to emphasize systems change in a district whose management was borderline dysfunctional, but they emphasized this to the exclusion of figuring out how to get more resources to schools and classrooms for children who are years behind academically or who simply can't learn because of trauma. Had they engaged the best teachers and principals in Newark, in district or charter schools, in planning their agenda, they might have taken a different approach. But this entire plan was formulated without the input of Newark residents or educators. In fact, Newark people learned about the revolution coming to their schools at the same moment as Oprah's national television audience. Mark Zuckerberg actually seems to have learned a lot from this experience. He and Priscilla Chan have announced that they will continue contributing to the cause of education for the most underserved children, but from now on they will work close to home in the Bay Area. They said they will work to understand the desires of communities and the complex needs of children they hope to help, a very different approach from the one in Newark. Within the very polarized national discussion about education, there's a debate over whether you can improve urban schools without first solving poverty. My reporting convinces me that you don't have to solve poverty to improve education for the poorest kids, but you definitely have to address it. And to address it, you need more resources at the school level. I'd like to return to the Kipp Elementary School I mentioned, Spark Academy, to tell you about something I witnessed that clarified this for me. One morning late in 2011, a mother of three students at the school was badly beaten by her boyfriend while her children were in school. The mother appeared in the school office, her face bleeding and swollen, clutching her newborn baby, whose skull had been fractured. She was desperate for help. The principal, Joanna Belcher, accompanied her and the baby to the hospital, persuaded her to file a police report, and then accompanied her to the courthouse, where they sat together for hours waiting for a lawyer to be assigned. I interviewed the lawyer who was assigned, and she said, "I had never seen that in all my career, a principal coming to court with a victim." Even more unusual was what happened back at the school, where the dean of student and family engagement, that extra position I told you about, took up the case. This is a position unheard of in district schools, a dean responsible for developing individualized help for children who are struggling because of issues outside the classroom. The dean created a carpooling schedule involving seven different staff members who would pick up the three children every morning at a neutral location. They were moved to a shelter and the address was secret, and returned them every day after school. The lead social worker, the one of three social workers, and most district schools have only one, formerly a teacher in the Bronx in a high school, held counseling sessions with the children and also guided their teachers on how to speak with them about the traumatic experience to help them feel safe and able to learn. Not one of those children missed even one day of school throughout their months in the shelter or the entire ordeal, and all of them finished the year above grade level. A district school teacher, with whom I've discussed this at length, put it to me this way: "We have to ask of every school, what does this particular school need in order to meet the challenges of the neighborhood it's situated in? And then we simply have to find the courage to provide it. We have to be able to show children, why is this education meaningful? And how can you possibly do that if so many other things are not working?" Thank you.
I will be shocked if there are not some questions. And if you have a question and could come to one of the two mics, that would be great.
Hi, Dale. My name is Mateo. Is this one? Yeah. Hi, my name is Mateus Baptista, a product of the Newark Public Schools, fortunate enough to have attended Science Park High School that you mentioned in the book. Thank you first for shining a light on what has been happening in Newark. And I think there's a phrase in your book where you talk about community relations versus public relations. And it's clear, I think a lot of people in Newark were not aware that this was already decided, right? Booker had made a plan well before its message to the public. And so going forward, do you see with Mayor Baraka potentially gaining control of the district, where do you see in your conversations with people how this could go forward? So do you think that the school district should be engaging people, but do you see hope? Did you talk to people and people already have a vision for where the district should be going?
I think one of the issues is that nobody seems to know how to go forward. There's been so much upheaval, and it really isn't so much because of the reform movement. It's because of the fiscal crisis in the school district. So many families have left the district because they've chosen charters, and the district was left with just massive overcapacity and fiscal crisis and just a debilitated system. So I think that what he's referring to is that Governor Christie and the mayor of Newark have agreed that Newark schools, which have been under the state's control for 20 years, and which is how this whole process came to happen because the state ran the schools, the local people didn't, and Christie and Booker made a plan, and they didn't have to go through the local community. But I think that, you know, the local community is going to have to make the same tough choices that were made, I mean, that have started to be made by the new, by the superintendent who was just fired. They're probably going to have to be schools closed, there's probably going to have to be layoffs, and it's going to be a very disruptive, difficult process. I do think that one thing that, there seems, because the city and the local school board has had no control for 20 years, there's almost like, I don't know if you agree, but just like a lethargy and a sense of hopelessness and pointlessness about even being involved in education, because you have no power and nothing that you do is going to make an impact. And I think that the idea that it's going to be locally controlled and there will be local responsibility has generated a lot of grassroots activity among people who are excellent educators and community, retired educators like Mary Bennett, you probably know. This is a woman who is a principal and a teacher for 40 years in the school district and knows more about education and about Newark and about the children of Newark than anybody. She was, of course, not consulted in this whole effort, but she's a leader now in the effort to pull the community together. And she told me that they're trying to recruit the sort of the best qualified people in Newark to run for the school board, people who would know how to deal with the finances and know how to deal with the pedagogy. And there's an effort to use some of the Zuckerberg money that's left to create some community schools, which would have not just services within the school, but services for the neighborhood and the community, because most of the neighborhoods in Newark, not all of them, but a lot of them need help. In addition to just the children needing help in the classroom, they need help outside the classroom. And so those are some of the things they're talking about. And I guess you can feel hopeful because there seems to be energy in the community about people taking responsibility for the schools for the first time in 20 years.
So. Thank you.
Two questions. Personally, why are teachers dogged so bad or used as scapegoats, considering that they're basically everything, social workers, psychologists, entertainer, and teachers, they influence all of us even more than our parents. And the second question, what is the magic bullet with charter schools?
The reason teachers are bullied, by politicians is that it's good politics. Chris Christie, the governor of New Jersey, has made his name nationally by going after the teachers union because there's a whole, national movement against public workers and the benefits and perks that public workers get and people who don't have a public pension or public health care, in the public sector. Private sector people feel like, well, I don't have those protections, and it's somebody to blame. Christie became just a master at marshaling that resentment. And he did it not only, in New Jersey, but he became a national figure doing it. He tweeted it out and he put it on YouTube and he was on Morning Joe all the time. And he became a star. And it just worked for him as kind of demagoguing teachers. Obviously some teachers are, not doing their jobs with heart and soul, but I think the majority of teachers are, and he used them, basically. And as for the silver bullet with charter schools, I think that charter schools are only as good as the people who run them and teach in them. But one thing that they do have is that, the Newark district, and I think a lot of big city districts have a lot of legacy costs in, just in their their long-term employees and their benefits and pensions. And plus, there's just a lot of extra fat and waste and patronage built into these systems. And the charter schools start fresh. It's kind of like FedEx and the post office. And so they can just get their money directly to the classroom more easily. And that's why, I feel the only hope that districts have, I think districts will die out. The way Uber is going to beat the taxis eventually, the charter schools will be getting so much more resources to the schools if districts don't figure out a way to take on all these old arrangements and get more money to the classrooms and figure out how to use that money to serve the kids. I don't know. I don't think it's a silver bullet, but it's just an easier vehicle right now for getting the money to the classroom. So.
Like, it just seems that way, the way people talk about it.
Well, they do. I know.
One educator said charter schools had the advantage of cherry picking their students, because teachers, like coaches, they're only good as their students.
Yes, well, there are a lot of charter schools that, you know, they're not held responsible by the state for having a fair and open process, and they do discourage, you know, the most difficult kids from coming, or once they've admitted them, they, you know, urge them to leave. And in Newark, the very highest performing charter school has a high school that's 73% female. So what does that tell you? Something's wrong, right? But they do have the highest scores. Because girls are so smart.
I first read about your book in when an excerpt from it was published in Education Week, and it made me so angry. Not with your writing, of course, but what I read about what was going on in those two pages was really, really upsetting to me. Full disclosure, I'm a retired professor of mathematics. My first teaching job was at Dartmouth College, where I was a research instructor. I taught at NYU for several years. Then most of my career was at the University of Massachusetts in Amherst. And I retired here, and I unretired when they needed me at George Washington University. But I finally retired in 2012 after 50 years of teaching. I looked at your I bought the book, and I looked at your index, and math was not mentioned. Now, the buzzword for reform of elementary and middle school and high school education is career and college ready. Okay, is there one school, elementary, middle, or high school? One classroom, one teacher, one student who, as a result of all this money, was moved closer to the path, to the goal of being college and career ready. I mean, how can anyone talk about education reform without talking about English literacy or mathematics? Those are the two goals without which you cannot function in today's economy. I mean, let me just add one more point. I remember reading Socrates, and I composed the following Socrates dialogue with Thrasymachus. Now, Thrasymachus, when you have a toothache, you go to a dentist, right? Yes, that's quite right, Socrates. And when you have a stomach ache, or a pain, you go to a doctor, right? And when you have a problem in math education, you go to a politician? I mean, it is absurd that this whole reform movement doesn't involve mathematicians like myself. I mean, I would voluntarily serve as a consultant for $500 a day.
Good set of questions.
You're underselling yourself. you're asking, was there any student who was helped?
Was there any, I mean, there are something called school improvement grants, which was also discussed in Education Week. And some school improvement grants failed, some succeeded, and they did get some useful information. Was any useful information derived from this experiment?
Well, I do know that Mark Zuckerberg has hired somebody to do a massive study of what was and wasn't accomplished by this effort, and it's not available yet. So I don't know what, and you know, there's all sorts of ways you could say that something was successful or something was unsuccessful, just depending on what numbers you look at. But I do know that they talk a lot about how the high school graduation rate increased 8 points since this whole effort began. But the students in the Newark high schools took the ACT, and in the schools that aren't the magnet high schools, like Science Park, like you mentioned, and aren't charter schools, the regular high schools were the college readiness ranged from 2% to 5% of the kids in the high school. So they're touting an 8% increase in the high school graduation rate. But again, what does graduation mean? And I, you know, I think that there was so much effort put into we're going to fix the systems, and very little effort put into what do you do in the classroom to actually help kids learn. But I should say that, you know, they did double the number of charter schools in Newark, and these, you know, there are very excellent charter schools, and I'm sure that those kids are doing better than they would have done. So I'm not saying that charter schools are a magic bullet, but they're, you know, the one I was just telling you about where they have so much support to make sure that the excellent teachers actually can reach the kids, they're doing a lot for kids there.
Okay, thank you.
Well, your book is a page turner. It's exciting, and I appreciate how fair you are to all the players and not assigning too much evil. I mean, actually, you know, it's an authentic look at the dynamics. But I'm trying to reconcile what you're saying about charters actually draining the public school system, and that's sort of by design, right? I mean, and it will eventually diminish, with the notion that community engagement or involvement is critical to success, or what, you know, the health of a community and of a school. So, and the charters are just very disruptive around local areas. I mean, you know, kids go all over, and you actually lose a certain community. I'm just having a hard time understanding what you think makes sense here, because this city is investing big time in charters, and they were talking yesterday when they're trying to do promised neighborhoods and consolidate support for poor kids. It's almost impossible with kids spread all over, or just the unequalness and the evidence that suggests that charter systems become more unequal rather than more equal in terms
right.
of disparity of opportunity.
Well, you know, I have to say, I'm not a policy expert. I've observed closely what I saw, and I don't really have answers. Mm-hmm. But I do think that there's one trend in school districts where charters are coming into urban areas, where the charter, if a charter organization is going to come in, they have to take a whole neighborhood school and serve the neighborhood just the same way the district did. Mm-hmm. And they're very reluctant to do that. They want to start with one grade and build one grade at a time to build their culture. And they want to be able to have people choose the school rather than serve the kids who are just in the neighborhood. But if charters are doing a better job, it seems to me they should be able to do a better job in that environment. And, you know, even if they don't get the same results, they should, you know, that keeps the neighborhood school intact and keeps it serving the community.
Well, I mean, it's interesting. Why are they doing a better job, and how do you replicate that in a public system? I mean, the data suggests charters perform about the same as public schools.
Nationally.
A third are excellent, a third are mediocre, and a third are terrible.
Right.
And that, so they're kind of like parallel measures for both charters. But the charters are making it harder and harder and driving up cost of public school systems. So, you know, per child. But anyway, thank you for this.
Thank you. Yeah.
Story.
Well, I'm going to keep thinking about that, but I don't have the answer.
Hi. Full disclosure, I haven't read the whole book. I have read reviews and summaries, and I do feel very strongly about these kinds of conversations. I'm 53 years old. When I was 10 years old, I got a scholarship to a private school, Dalton Schools, in New York City. My question is there any part of the book where you kind of go off on a tangent and consider our unspoken obviates, you know, what we take for granted in these kinds of discussions? For instance, a point of in New York City, there are schools that were started in the early 20th century in the poorest of neighborhoods that are now magnets, you know, that are you know, Brandeis University, the fellow who was up here, I think he went to university. You know, they were started, so poverty doesn't mean that a child can't learn or doesn't want to learn, all right? The fundamental issue is culture, and a culture that values learning, all right? And what is our end result? The purpose of education is not to produce a lot of Einsteins. It can, but most of the people in this room are not Einsteins. They're nice people. Intelligent, you know, able to function in the public sphere. Is there a part in the book where you deal with our a priori's? What is the public sphere? What do we want? You know, what are we trying to do? What kind of norms are we trying to socialize these people into? And what are we starting with? There's no such thing as a tabula rasa. A child is not a tabula rasa. And the reason he or she isn't a tabula rasa, not because they're poor, but you're not dealing with, you know, what black culture is, for instance, I mean, the presumptions we're talking about black kids in the public school systems, right?
Well, but, black and Puerto Rican and Central American.
Right. So that's my question. Is there a part in your book where there you sort of question our fundamental presumptions?
No, there's not. But
tell Mark Zuckerberg to call me. I'll give it to him for $100. That's why they always fail.
Right. Well, there's always maybe there'll be a paperback edition, and I'll try to do that.
They'll always fail if they don't do that. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi. I was a media specialist in a public school for 30 years, public schools, and there's so many areas in which public education is broken, I couldn't even begin to touch on them, but I feel like the public really doesn't even know what they are. The last 5 years, I'm finally retired, we spent meeting after meeting going over data to analyze test scores and then targeting, you know, the kids that we thought could move over the line and make the green line for passing the test. We'd put all our eggs into that basket and put extra help on those kids. And then the kids that we thought couldn't come up that far, that's too bad for them. But what happened during this No Child Left Behind and testing is that we totally lost focus on pedagogy, on teacher training. And I think what people don't understand, I was listening to an NPR show recently, and they were looking at these successful school systems in Japan, and they were looking at mathematics. And one of the things that they found was that, first of all, many Japanese teachers got together, observed each other's lessons, were able to evaluate what worked and what didn't, and they found that spending an entire classroom session on one problem versus in American schools going through many, many problems so the kids really never figured out the steps. They really never got it down. Something that simple, if Mark Zuckerberg would have just looked at that kind of procedure, really could have made an impact. But we're so press-oriented and so, you know, get rid of the bad teachers, and we do that by looking at test scores. Teachers don't get time to work together. They don't get training. And the other thing I just did want to mention, that because I could do hundreds, is when he looks at a business model for running schools, I've had six principals in my career, and one was absolutely exhilarated about the latest pedagogy, understood what it was, knew education as an educator. He'd been a teacher a long time, which many administrators are not. Our whole system of principals in the public education is really horrific, and how many don't belong there, and how little oversight there's been, and what morale and climate they create in a school. There are just so many issues, and we have these quick fixes, and that's why we're where we are.
I agree, and I think those are important points. One of the first thing you said about just no time to collaborate or to observe other teachers, one thing that's just so interesting, there's been a study, millions of studies, but this one in particular is fascinating because it shows that out of all the industrialized countries, the United States in education, teachers have less time to observe other teachers or to just reflect on their practice or to, you know, be to have coaching and evaluation. Just all of they spend so much more time in the classroom than teachers in all the other countries that do much better than us on these standardized tests. So it's a huge flaw. And you know, I think that, you know, his idea, you know, he had a very impressionistic idea about trying to make teaching a higher status profession, but to make it a really important profession would require, you know, giving teachers the opportunity that all other professionals have to really reflect on their work and to observe other people who do the work with them and to come up with a better, you know, a better way of teaching and to continually improve. I mean, the idea is, oh, after 5 years, teachers are, you know, at their proficient level. And I think that teachers, the most experienced teachers are the ones who are the most thrilled to have a chance to observe new ideas and have people come in and give them suggestions on how to j- just make their practice even better. So there's just an awful lot wrong with it.
Don't know much about all this, but I'm sort of wondering from what I've been listening tonight, would it have made more sense if Zuckerberg had taken that $100 million, divided it by the number of schools in New York, and sent a check directly to each school?
I think if the principals had known how to use the resources and direct it to the needs of the kids, I think that actually would have been a lot better. But the only problem is then that money would have run out, and then they would have been back to where they were. I think that that was one reason they didn't send the money to the classroom, is that they were trying to figure out things they could do that would change the system and last. And I think, unfortunately, they didn't really change the system. The money's gone. Yeah, right. And the money is gone. Yeah. Oh, sorry.
Could you talk a bit about what you think what's happened in Newark means for the future of corporate philanthropy in education? Do you think it's going to put people off doing what Zuckerberg did, or do you think it's just going to make them more careful about how they do what they do?
I don't know that anybody really has done what he did, you know, just go and give a large sum of money to, you know, a city and ask the politicians to figure out how to spend it well. I think that really that was almost counter to the trend of corporate philanthropy, which is very targeted, and there are benchmarks, and if you meet the benchmarks, then you get the money, and there are metrics to evaluate. You know, it's almost like, you know, it's a business model. And I think that, you know, probably there won't be these open-ended gifts again. But I do hope that corporate philanthropists, as you say, won't give up on school districts, because, you know, this whole idea that charters are the answer, that charters are never going to educate the majority of kids in this country. There's so many communities where no philanthropist is going to come in and subsidize the beginning of a charter, and district schools are where the kids are. And if we don't figure out how to make them more effective, none of this really is going to change anything. So, hi, Mike.
I was just hoping you could tell us a little bit, rather than in addition to policy, about your experience of reporting this book in Newark. I mean, you must have had some interesting days, and I'm curious what the response was to you, and how difficult that might have been at first to just walk into Newark as the writer or the person who was going to write this book.
It was such a long, I was there for such a long time. It's hard to remember what it was like at first. But at first, everybody said, you know, what is the white lady doing here? And there was a teacher at one of the high schools who read my book, and she said she was passing it around the school, and that a lot of people said, so is that white lady who was here the whole time? So I guess I was that white lady. And actually, the other thing is that the kids all thought that I was really this really old lady, because, you know, their mothers are so young, and I was probably the age of their great-grandmothers, you know. And so a lot of them, they called me Miss Dale, because Russakoff was more than they could deal with, I guess. And then some of them who couldn't remember Dale just called me Granny. So I'm not even a grandmother, but I was constantly reminded of just the cultural, you know, gap between us. You know, I have to say, people were, I mean, when I went and just talked to people one-on-one, I found them so eager to talk. It was just like, you know, sometimes as a reporter, when you do a story and you just start running into people who knew they had a story and they were just waiting for somebody to come say, tell me that story. And it was almost like you can throw out all your questions because they've been writing this story in their heads for 40 years. And interviews that I thought were going to last maybe a half an hour would sometimes last 2 hours. And then we would arrange to meet again. And it was just like so exciting. And I think that, you know, that made me feel welcome. And when I went to large meetings, and I was often the only white person in the room, I think it didn't look as odd to me as it did to everyone else. Because I looked around and, you know, there was nothing odd. Everyone was, you know, of color. And then they looked around and I was sticking out like a sore thumb. So, but, you know, I think that it's just like any story you do, you just keep coming back and eventually you're just there, you know. And I think that another thing about writing the whole project was just interviewing Mark Zuckerberg, which was the most surreal experience, because I was extremely nervous when I went to interview him the first time, because I was interviewing this incredibly wealthy billionaire who had changed global communications on the face of the earth. And on the other hand, I was also interviewing someone who looked like one of my kids. And, you know, I just sort of felt like, you know, God, he looks like Sam's roommate or something, you know? And he was like a little bit of both, you know, but really more Sam's roommate than, you know, the global king of communications. And he was like, you know, having seen The Social Network, I kind of thought, oh, this guy's obnoxious and he's socially, you know, awkward and on the spectrum and everything. And he was actually an extremely nice guy. And I found him to be unassuming. And he basically said, I really don't know much about philanthropy and I don't know anything about education. And he thought, in working with Cory Booker and Chris Christie, that he was going to learn from the experts, how do you make philanthropy work? And they really, you know, they weren't experts, they were politicians, and they responded in kind, you know, sort of. So I think he learned a lot from that. But his wife, she was his girlfriend when I met her, and then they got married. And I actually sensed the time that when I interviewed them that there was just this incredible, just special warmth between them. And it was like the following weekend that they announced they were engaged. So I obviously picked up on the, you know, radar, right? But anyway, she is an absolutely amazing person. And she's like, you know, it made me think so highly of him that he's married to her. She came from a really disadvantaged family herself. Her parents were Vietnamese and Chinese refugees. And they worked, both of them, 18 hours or more every day in Chinese restaurants and in double jobs and everything. And she was raised by her grandmother, who spoke no English, and nobody in the family had been to college. And she went to public school in Quincy, Massachusetts, and she had a couple of public school teachers who saw her potential, and she believes put her on a path to go to Harvard, and that she never would have. They even got her to play tennis because they thought tennis was a good thing, you know, to have on your resume if you go to Harvard. And I mean, she was just like, you know, completely kind of made, shaped like clay by these teachers, and she's still close to them and still grateful to them. And when she got to Harvard, she said she felt totally out of place there because, you know, she was from this incredibly different world. And there was a fair, she said, of all of the activities you could choose from. And there was one that was a volunteer activity that you could work in these very low-income housing projects in the Dorchester area of Boston. And you could be a mentor to kids, both an academic mentor and a life mentor. And she did that starting her freshman year. And from her sophomore through her senior year, she ran the program. And she said that she just felt like, oh my God, these kids are me. They've just got, you know, all they need is somebody to help them. They've had a rough life and it's not easy for them, but I can make a difference in these kids' lives. And then she said that, you know, so many of them, that the problems were just overwhelming, that, you know, you could tutor them and you could do all kinds of things. But, you know, like there was one child who'd been absent from the program and absent from school for weeks. And it turned out that he had gotten in a fight and somebody had knocked out his teeth, and the family didn't have the insurance to go get his teeth fixed, and he was just ashamed to show up and ashamed to go to school. And you know, she just said that there, you know, it kind of introduced her to so many things that just, you know, she had to start thinking about. And she ended up she became a pediatrician in community medicine, taking care of kids whose families don't have health insurance. And she takes care of the most underserved kids in the San Francisco area, as foster children and children, you know, who've been abused and neglected. And you know, it's just who she is. And so she, and actually what she's doing with their philanthropy now is she wants to start a school for kids who have experienced trauma early on, and she wants the school to be housed in a community health center where there would be services and actual medical care for kids so that their trauma could be treated at an early age. And maybe, you know, and she wants it to start in preschool so that maybe by the time they're in elementary school, they'll actually be ready to learn effectively. So I just feel like, you know, she's just an incredibly substantial person. And the fact that they have all this money and that they're committed to underserved kids, is a good thing. And I think that they just got a bad start.
Hi. So I went to a charter school, and it was kind of a unique school in that we went to school 3 days a week, and then the other 2 days you had off. You worked from home. It was a cyber blend. And it seems like, looking back, the things that you get out of that kind of model, the ability to work independently, to get your homework done on your own, to work as a team because you get all sorts of creative assignments beyond what's in a traditional classroom, would be something that I think that public schools could do, could adopt for at least some students to keep them in the district, where if the parents were looking at a private option. Do you know if any public schools are experimenting, districts are experimenting with using a cyber blend model or entirely online or any other type of innovative delivery system? Because it seems like it could really save a lot of costs if you could create that kind of model in a district.
You know, I don't know, but I just have to assume that they are, because there's so much innovation.
I just haven't seen it anywhere except the one school I went to in Pennsylvania.
And does anybody know? I mean, do you think?
Well, I know Montgomery County is experimenting. A lot of districts are using Chromebooks now. Not the two-day off model. I don't know how a public system could ever do that.
The alternative there is that they created a center, which is where the students come in when they're not in class on the other days. So you go in, you get to socialize with your peers, you also have the flexibility to do community service. You can do a lot of things with that unstructured time while still attending your classes and working independently.
I would like to say that the media centers are going in that direction, but about a third of the year became a testing center. And all the research and all the collaboration went out the window because the computers were needed for testing. That's a huge problem.
Yeah, testing shapes everything.
We've got time only for a few more questions. How many people, I can't see all of you. Are there two people, three people in line? Two people?
Three.
Could you keep the question short and sweet? And if you don't mind being brief and concise, we'll wrap up after these three.
Ma'am, I thank you. I look forward to reading the book. I'm actually fighting the inverse of what you described. In my hometown, we had an award-winning school recognized nationally that the local district closed. But because I'm from a hometown of 700 people, and 70%, over 70% poor or free and reduced lunch, the school district closed it because of some internal politics. So I'm looking to, and I can't get anybody in Albany. I'm from upstate New York, so I can't get anybody in Albany because we are a small town to listen. So I look forward to seeing the insights that gained from your book. But my
question, what's the name of the town?
Cleveland, New York.
Cleveland, New York.
Syracuse is the nearest city.
Okay.
But my question, ma'am, is, do you see parallels potentially, and I recognize you're not a policy expert, but parallels between the urban poor and the rural poor, because the urban poor get a lot of the publicity where the rural poor are not, their story isn't being told. So thank you.
Well, I think that's an interesting point, because the focus of the education reform movement on charters, you know, works for big cities because philanthropists and you know, the big talent pool of teachers, that's where they are. But it doesn't work for rural areas. And I think that's one of the issues, that most kids are not in communities where charters are going to be flourishing. And what about those district schools, and who's going to help them?
Yes, ma'am. In fact, I'm trying to start the first rural charter school in New York City.
Okay. I'd like to come do that story. Okay. I'd like to get your name. Seriously.
I'm curious about the role of the consultants, other than draining the system of money. I mean, did they add anything? Did they have any value? Did you interview them? Were they qualified?
Well, I've gotten calls from a lot of angry consultants saying that I've impugned their industry. But unfortunately, there were some people who did some really good work. But overall, There was just this sense that we need to hire these experts, and we have to pay them top dollar because they have this special knowledge that nobody else has, and we're going to bring them in, and we're going to change the management of this school district, and they created an entirely new evaluation system for the teachers, and they spent something like $4 million on it, and they had a very fine evaluation system before, but they just wanted this reform-oriented consulting firm to do a brand new teacher evaluation system. There was another case where one of the donors to the matching fund was Goldman Sachs, and one of the executives of Goldman Sachs had also been a founder of a particular education reform consulting firm. And so he arranged that if Goldman Sachs gave $5 million to the matching fund, that they would have to, that the reform effort would have to agree to hire this consulting firm. So they paid them $600,000 to do a recommendation and a study of how to spend the money, and then they ignored it because they already had hired another consulting firm that they paid $2.9 million to do a study of how to spend the money. So it was just, I mean, it was almost like, you know, you just hire these people, and you have to hire them because they know everything, and they don't. And they also don't know anything about the community. So, like, what are all these big plans when you don't know how they're going to affect a child, a family, a neighborhood? It was just like as if somehow you don't have to think about that. Those kids don't have to be real to you. It can just be abstract. And that was, to me, what was troubling about it. You know, it was like not so much, let's take these people, these really smart people, and have them analyze what we can do to really help this school function better in this neighborhood. But, you know, how can we, you know, they talk like, you know, we've got to build the airplane while we're flying it. And we've got to move the needle. And we've got to, you know, drill deep. And, I mean, there were just like all of these phrases that I started hearing. And it's apparently the language of consultants. But they all talk about it. And it was just like you just started hearing buzzwords everywhere. And, oh, and everything like, what about the evaluation bucket? Everything has to be in a bucket. And I'd never heard of this. But, you know, anyway, I mean, education has tons of, you know, lingo and jargon. But this was another whole thing.
We're going to answer with you, but okay. before we get to you, just a reminder that we have plenty of copies of Dale's fantastic, amazing book, if I haven't made that clear, just to remind you. Up at the front, she'll be happy to sign copies here, and if you could just fold your chairs and put them to the side at the end, and you've got the last word.
Okay, I'll be very quick. You alluded to this issue at the top of your discussion about previous philanthropy in the last century and whatnot. The Rosenwald movie that's playing up the street seemed like he did a much better job at giving his money away and having success. Is that your judgment as well, that their previous century philanthropists did it better than the current ones? You can't do it worse, perhaps, than the current ones, but were they successful in your judgment, or have you studied that issue, perhaps, is the question.
You know, I feel like I'm not qualified to say, but I have to believe that they made some huge mistakes and they made some great, you know, achievements along the way. I know that the northern industrialists spent a lot of their philanthropy on the schools in the South for former slaves, mm-hmm. and some of them were disastrous and some of them weren't. And and I guess the Rosenwald schools were the best or among the best. I haven't seen the movie, but I really want to see it. Okay, thank you.
Dale, thank you so much.